With us on the line is, we call him actor, director, comedian, author, filmmaker, Paul Provenza.
I can't hold a job.
Unemployable. We'll call you freelancer.
How are you, Ms. Dupuis?
Very good, very good. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Real quick, could you walk us through, our viewers, through Gilbert Gottfried, 9/11, and the Hugh Hefner roast?
At the Hefner roast, which was only about 6 weeks after, maybe even a little less, about a month after 9/11, being amongst comedians and the friars, and it being a roast, which is traditionally, there are no lines to cross. He did a joke about, he said something like, I'm trying to get across, I'm trying to get a flight to Los Angeles, but I can only get one that stops at the Empire State Building, something like that.
Right.
And the crowd was yelling too soon, there were groans, all that sort of stuff. And actually, when you watch the tapes, kind of half and half, half people, were doing that playfully and half really meant it. And so Gilbert, in what I believe, this is the puppet show in my head, this is the narrative for Gilbert that I have, which is just that, I've crossed the line, I can't back down now. So he went a totally other, different direction and started to do the Aristocrats joke, which of course is crossing lines of a different nature, and just destroyed. And it was kind of like he kind of slapped everybody on the wrist. It was almost as if he was saying, what do you mean too soon? What do you mean there are lines? We're comics,
right?
And this is what we do, and this is what we do especially here. And he just went for broke and went into totally, as far as he could possibly go with that Aristocrats joke, and basically told everybody, no, there are no lines to cross, It was really interesting, and it was really it had a big effect on a lot of the people in comedy that were there, which I suppose was most of the people who were there, just in terms of kind of putting everything back into perspective in terms of what it is that we do, for better or worse.
Was that event kind of the inspiration to do an entire documentary about that joke, about the Aristocrats joke?
No, we had actually been in production on a documentary for about a year already.
Oh, wow.
Before that. And in fact, we had taped Gilbert in a private session doing that joke about 3 weeks before 9/11. That may be one of the reasons why he was so facile with it. He had just spent hours in a room with us just a couple of weeks ago going through every permutation he could come up with. In fact, that session in private is on the DVD as well. It's also included, parts of it are included in the movie as well. So no, it wasn't the inspiration, but without planning to, I think we might have created our own third act by just getting it up to the forefront of Gilbert's brain at that point in time.
What's your opinion of his Twitter jokes in the wake of the Japan meltdown or tsunami and earthquake?
A joke is a joke. It's that simple. A joke is a joke. So I am of the school of thought, along with people like George Carlin and many others of note, who feel like there is no subject that's off limits, and they're just jokes. And jokes can be insensitive, and jokes do have victims, and people can feel sympathy for those victims, and that's part of the dynamic. And that's what makes jokes like that interesting to do, because you're tightrope walking as a comedian. You're not playing it safe. You're seeing if you can make something funny out of something tragic, which is, real work. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. And there are just as many people who found those jokes that Gilbert twittered hilarious as who found them offensive. But, it's also important to remember that you can find them hilarious and offensive at the same time and understand that they're just jokes. The truth is that everybody's right. Gilbert's absolutely right to do whatever jokes he feels like doing. And Aflac is absolutely right to say, you're associated with our company and you're presenting the wrong image and we don't like it. And that's what happens when you mix art and commerce. It happens all the time. Penn put it perfectly, actually. I do have to quote him because he really is very clear on this. He put it perfectly. He said, Gilbert, they hired you for your words and they fired you for your words.
One final question, Paul, I still have you on the, do you think that as a comic, this is kind of the problem with Twitter, that like if you are on stage and you say something that people start booing, you ultimately have a saver and you have an opportunity to bring them back with you, but Twitter, it's kind of out there and it's photographed and then it, you know, and it's taken, it can be pretty much out of context. You lose control of whatever you're saying. And you can lose control of your audience.
Yes, that's true. But what it really boils down to is this, is that, you know, we're not idiots. And I feel like in these regards, we're always treated as idiots. Why don't you let us make our own choices, you know? But again, this has nothing to do with free speech because this is a corporate gig. You have to toe the line, and that's the job you took. Gilbert made the choice to make that big paycheck. And wanted to still be Gilbert.
Thank
you. And for the most part, I suppose, for the most part, he was able to. I mean, this is an extraordinary circumstance. And, you know, I mean, it's a major event, and a lot of people suffered. And Gilbert made a joke that in a room full of 200 people is one thing. But, you know, on the internet, in the Twitter universe, that's a big crowd. And if you piss off 1% of that crowd, that's a few million people.
Paul Provenza, thanks for joining us. As always,
My
you were
pleasure.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.